Some years I choose to do a Christmas series before Christmas days, and then some years I choose not to do so. And this year I have chosen not to do so. I'm going to preach on Christmas, the Sunday before Christmas. But what I want to do this year is I want us to stay in 1 John because I want to try to finish that book before the year is out, because I really have something on my heart that I want to move into in January. But we have something that's before us today that I really believe can make a radical impact on our lives if we will hear and we will go out and practice and do what the Scripture says. I want to ask you a couple of questions in beginning this morning. And the first question is there anything in life that we can know or we can experience that is perfect? Anything at all that we could say we can know this or we can experience this and it is perfect? For example, is there such a thing as a perfect wife? Or is there such thing as a perfect husband or a perfect child or a perfect parent? Have you ever heard of anyone say, well, I have a perfect job? I really don't think that there's anything in life that is perfect. Everything has a flaw in it. And because it has a flaw in it, then it removes away from that particular thing being perfect and us being able to experience it in perfection. Second question I want to ask is, why did God save us? Why did God come down and send His Son, the Lord Jesus, to redeem us from our sins? Did He do that simply that He might take us to heaven when we die? Or did He do that simply that He might bless us in this life? Why did God save us? And you see, the answer to that question is important, because the answer to that question goes right along with the first question that I asked. God saved us for one reason. And that is that you and I might experience and we might express perfect love. The one thing that we can know and experience in this life that is perfect love. That's what I want to talk to us today out of the book of 1 John, chapter number 4. So if you have your Bibles, turn there, look with me. 1 John chapter 4, we're going to begin reading at verse number 12 and go down through the end of this chapter. 1 John chapter 4 and verse number 12. Perfect love is the title of our sermon. The Bible says in verse 12 that no one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us, and His love has been perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in Him, and He in us, because He has given us of His Spirit. And we have seen and testify that the Father has sent the Son as Savior of the world. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God abides in Him, and He in God. And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love. And he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. If someone says, I love God and hates his brother, he is a liar, for he does not love his brother whom he has seen. How can he love God whom he has not seen? And this commandment we have from him, for he who loves God must love his brother also. Now, if you have been with us so far in our study through the book of 1 John, I know probably what you're thinking about now, and that is, here we go again. Because this is the fourth time in this little book that this subject, this theme of love has come up. In four particular passages of Scripture, we see that love is the theme of those particular passages. Now, we might say that love in 1 John 4, in these latter verses, reaches its crescendo or its high water mark. Did you know that out of these verses that the word perfect or the word perfective, It occurs four times. The word love occurs 16 times. So there is no doubt that what John is talking about in these verses is the theme of perfect love. Now, I want us to keep in mind this morning as we go through these verses, keep in mind that the word perfect or perfected in the scripture always means that which is complete. As a matter of fact, you could take this to mean reaching maturity. And since he's talking to believers here, what he's referring to is reaching spiritual maturity. Now, don't miss this. What John is trying to get us to see is that when you and I experience spiritual maturity, when that is the experience of our lives, then love will be involved. As a matter of fact, we will never climb up the plateau of spiritual maturity apart from this one little four-letter word that is the word love. So the way that we gauge our maturity and our walk with God and our love for the Lord and whether or not we're really living in obedience to Him is whether or not we have reached spiritual maturity. And the way that we know that we have reached spiritual maturity is whether or not biblical, godly, agape love is at work in our lives. Now, there are four specific things I hope that I have time to deal with that are mentioned in these few verses. And the first thing that he mentions down in verse number one is what I simply want to call perfect love's completion. Perfect love's completion. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us, and His love has been perfected in us. Now, there are a couple of things that are stated here in verse number 12 that I believe gives us an understanding of what it is that is meant by the statement that I just made of perfect love's completion. Number one is the evidence that is expressed. Now, here is the question that I ask. What evidence is really being expressed when we are living out the kind of love that John is referring to here? What is being expressed? Well, there are two things according to these verses that are being expressed. Number one is God is real. Number two is God dwells in us. So when we are living in such a way where we are demonstrating, exhibiting, expressing the love of God to others, then we are demonstrating that God is real and that God really does abide in us. Now, I think just a casual reading of verse number 12, you might read that verse, the first part of that verse, and think, you know what? This is kind of out of place. When John says, no one has seen God at any time. And then he follows that up by saying, but if we love one another, then God's love has been perfected in us. But when you put that whole verse together, it's easy to see what John is trying to say. What John is trying to say is that the invisibility of God, the fact that He cannot be seen, goes right along with this whole idea of love, which I am teaching. Because what I'm trying to get you to see is no one has ever seen God with the physical eyes. As a matter of fact, the Bible says that God is spirit. No one can see Him. I mean, in a tangible way, no one can, with their physical eye, see God and say, I know that God exists. But John says, when the world sees us loving with the perfect love of God, reaching out and demonstrating that love to others, then the world knows that God is real because the world sees that God really does abide and dwell and live within you. You know, it's hard to convince somebody who cannot see God that God is. It's a very difficult thing to try to convince somebody that there really is a God when they cannot look out with their physical eyes and see them. Did you know that we could sit down with someone, let's say for maybe 24 hours, and we could teach them systematic theology? We could sit down with someone and we could highlight all of the attributes of God. We could sit down with someone and we could prove to them the historicity of Christianity. And still their eyes probably would be closed when it comes to the reality of God, and they would still be unbelieving in their hearts. But dear friends, when people see us loving as Jesus loved, then they are much more open to hearing and receiving the gospel of Jesus Christ. The longer that I live, the more that I am convinced that the world today is not clamoring to hear the gospel. But the world today is longing to see the gospel. And when the world sees the gospel by the way that you and I live, then they are open to the gospel. There is an old poem, perhaps you have heard it or read it, one of my favorite, that was written by a man by the name of Edgar Guest. And the title of that poem is simply Sermons We See. He went on in that poem and he stated, "I'd rather see a sermon than hear one any day. I'd rather one should walk with me than merely tell the way. The eye's a better pupil and more willing than the ear. Fine counsel is confusing, but example's always clear. And the best of all preachers are the men who live their creeds. For to see good put in action is what everybody needs." Can I get a witness? And you see, that kind of living would turn the world upside down. John says that love is the evidence that God exists. So when others look at me and they see me loving as Jesus loved and demonstrating that love, they're going to be willing to listen to what I have to say. I read a story one time, supposedly a true story, happened years ago. There was this little homeless boy in a downtown city, and this little homeless boy was dirty, and his clothes were very ragged, and this very wealthy, loving, godly Christian lady saw this little boy, and he was peering into the window of a shoe store. And the lady came by and she said, "Son, what are you doing?" And the little boy said, "Ma'am, I'm praying." He said, "I'm praying that God would give me a pair of shoes." And so the kind lady took him inside the store and asked the store owner if he could give her a pail of water. And he gave her this little bowl of water, and the lady knelt down and she washed his dirty feet. Then she bought him a nice pair of warm socks and put them on him. Then she bought him a nice pair of comfortable warm boots, put those on his feet. And then it is said that the little boy looked at the kind, compassionate, gracious, godly lady and asked the question, "Ma'am, are you God's wife?" When was the last time somebody asked me, because of the way that I'm living, "Are you God's child?" Because of a kind deed, a good act, a loving gift, a meeting of a need, someone would look at me and say, "Are you God's child?" And so I think the first thing that we see is the evidence then that is expressed. But then secondly, the goal that is achieved. What is God's goal for our lives when He saves us? I asked that in the beginning. Is it just to take us to heaven when we die? Is it to give us blessings in this life right now? What is God's goal? Well, we see God's goal achieved right here. And God's goal that is achieved is that His love might be perfected in us. That's God's goal for our lives. God saves us to produce His perfecting love within us. You see, God's love is proclaimed in His word. And God's love was proven at the cross. But God's love is to be perfected in us as believers. God's love is not perfected in the angels, but God's love is perfected in those of us who are sinners, who have been saved by the grace of God. But why does God want to perfect His love in us, as verse number 12 says? Well, God has saved us to perfect His love in us in order that His love might flow through us. And dear friend, here is the real evidence of spiritual maturity. It really is. The real evidence of spiritual maturity is not how many times we've read our Bibles through in a year, as important as that is. The real evidence is not how many hours of our lives that we have devoted to prayer, as important as that is. But the real evidence of spiritual maturity is simply this, is God's love being perfected in me to the degree that it is flowing through me and it's reaching out and it's touching others. Am I simply a reservoir for God's love, or am I a channel for God's love? Does God's love not simply dwell within me, but does God's love flow through me? You see, dear friend, that's the evidence. God's goal is that after we have received the love of God, is that we might get out here and we might practice the love of God. And when His love is received and His love is perfected, the most perfect expression of the love of God is not in what I say, but it's what I do, and it's how I live. And that's what John is trying to get us to see. And so we see that God's love is perfected, which is His goal for our lives. There's a second thing that we see, and that is perfect love's companion. Perfect love's companion. Now, I want us to get this, because I'm telling you, apart from this, we will never be able to live out the perfect love of God. Verse number 13, by this we know that we abide in Him and He in us, because He has given of us His Spirit. See, it's the Holy Spirit who is our companion that enables that love to be perfected through us. Remember what Galatians chapter 5 says, but the fruit of the Spirit is what? Love. As a matter of fact, there are many scholars, and I would not disagree with them, who would say that love is the fruit, and then the joy and the peace and the patience and long-suffering and all of those other things just flow out of that first piece of fruit, which is love. So he says that the fruit of the Spirit is love, and that is perfect love's companion, the Holy Spirit of God. But the question is, when do we receive the Holy Spirit of God? And the answer is at the moment of our conversion. The moment that we get born again, the Holy Spirit of God moves into our hearts and He becomes our eternal companion. And then He produces that love that He's telling us that we ought to be demonstrating. There are those today who tell us that we can get saved by the grace of God, and then at a later date that we can receive the Holy Spirit. But that is utterly impossible, and that is utterly unscriptural. Because the Apostle Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter number 12, verse number 13, for by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body. You see, we're not baptized with the Spirit, we are baptized by the Spirit into the body of Christ, the moment that we trust Jesus as our Lord and Savior. So there is one baptism, but then there are many fillings of the Spirit. There are times that we sin. There are times that we need to repent. And every time that we do that, we are filled afresh and anew with the Holy Spirit of God. But at the moment of conversion, God comes to live in our lives through the Holy Spirit. And then because of that, the love that we have for others is commensurate with the character of the God who lives within us. And so apart from the Holy Spirit living in our hearts, that there is no possible way that we could ever love the way that John is telling us that we ought to love. It is so interesting that when we trace the dwelling places of God throughout the Scripture to see what they are. You know, when we go back to the book of Genesis, we see that God had a very unique and special relationship with the first man and the first woman. The Bible says that He walked with them, and literally He talked with them, and He fellowshiped with them in a way that was personal and close up, and it was a way that was intimate. But then you remember the rest of the story. Sin entered the picture, and then God had to go out and kill some animals and shed their blood in order that that fellowship might be restored. And then the Bible says after that that God walked with men like Abraham and Noah and Enoch. And then when we flip the page from the book of Genesis to the book of Exodus, the Bible tells us that God dwelt with man in an entirely different way. The Old Testament tabernacle was constructed. The Bible says that when Moses dedicated that tabernacle, that the glory of God, which was the presence of God, that it filled that place and God's presence dwelt there in the tabernacle. But then sin entered the picture. And Ezekiel the prophet said, the glory of God, the presence of God, departed from that tabernacle. And then you remember they built the temple. And when they built the temple after that, they dedicated it. And when they dedicated the temple, the glory of God returned. And it filled up the Holy of Holies. And there the presence of God dwelt. But then sin entered the picture again. And the question is, well, did God's glory ever return? And the answer is yes. Because John the Baptist in John chapter 1 and verse number 14 looked at Jesus and said, behold, the Lamb of God who is full of grace and truth. And John said, we saw his glory. It was the glory as of the only begotten of the Father who was full of grace and truth. And the glory of God or the presence of God dwelt in the person of Jesus Christ to the degree that that body back then was the temple of God. That's where God dwelt. But then you will remember that wicked sinners took that body and they crucified that body. But 3 days later, that body rose from the dead. And that body, the body of Jesus, went back into heaven. And when he went back to heaven, he sent his Holy Spirit. And his Holy Spirit then came to indwell believers. And Jesus promised in John 14, verse 16, my spirit now will abide in you forever, and he will never leave. And I can imagine those Old Testament Israelites standing out in front of the Old Testament tabernacle, looking in with wonder and amazement, saying, man, God dwells in that building. But friend, that is absolutely nothing compared to every day when we as believers get out of bed and look in the mirror, because we can say, man, God dwells in this body. And you see, that's where the presence of God dwells today. And it's because of the presence of God that dwells in you and dwells in me now that we can love in this way that John is telling us that we ought to love. And dear friend, if we want to gauge our spiritual maturity today, we ought not look at the envelope that we check off on Sunday morning that we hand into our Sunday school classes saying, read my Bible daily, prayed daily, giving. We ought not check off those boxes as the criteria for our spiritual maturity. But is God's love being perfected in me to the degree that I am reaching out in the name of Jesus and I am loving others? You see, that's God's goal. His goal for your life and his goal for my life. So perfect love's companion. There's a third thing that we see, and that is perfect love's confession. Perfect love's confession. Down in verses 14 and 15, verse 14 he says, and we have given, or we have seen, and we testify that the Father hath sent the Son as the Savior of the world. Now that's a Christmas message right there, isn't it? So we testify this, we have seen this. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God abides in him and he in God. What John is saying is that if we abide in Christ, then the love of God abides in us. And if the love of God abides in us, guess what? We are going to be testifying that to others. We're going to be telling them Jesus is the Son of God, the Savior of the world. My friend, if you listen right here, say amen. The Lord Jesus Christ didn't simply preach the love of God, but he practiced the love of God and he proved the love of God. It is not enough just to preach the love of God. Friend, I want to tell you that unless we love lost people, our verbal witness will be absolutely useless. Useless. unless we reach out to them and love them in the name of the Lord Jesus. The Lord Jesus both declared and demonstrated the gospel. What was the gospel? The gospel was a message of love. And if we ever expect to win unsaved people to Christ, listen, not only must we declare the gospel, we must demonstrate the gospel. And we must do that by how that we live. I'm afraid today that too much witnessing is just the mouthing of words. Just the mouthing of words. Just memorize a plan. Be able to get that plan out and put that plan on people. Too much just the mouthing of words. Friend, I want to tell you, people today and this day need an expression of the love of God. We are living in a world that is seeing so much hypocrisy in the church that the world isn't going to believe a thing the church has to say until the church really starts loving lost people the way that Jesus loves lost people. And I want to tell you, if there's one message that this old world needs today, it is the message of love. Because this world knows nothing about love. This world doesn't have a clue what love is. We are trying to reach a young generation today that has been raised with a spirit of narcissism where everything is about them. They know nothing about love. Want to know how the world spells love? Three-letter word, S-E-X. That's how the world spells love. How does the Bible spell love? S-E-R-V-E. A five-letter word. And dear friend, that's the message that the world needs to see and that the world needs to hear today. And I'm telling you, show me a family. You show me a family, a home, a marriage where there is that kind of love. And I'll show you a family where there's security. And you show me a relationship where there is that kind of love. And I'll show you a relationship where there's safety and there's security. You show me a world where there is that kind of love. And I'll show you a world that is a better place to live. And dear friend, I want to ask you and I want to ask me today, during this Christmas season and carrying on out after this Christmas season, will we commit ourselves to love people as Jesus loved them? I think that we can make a difference in our city and in our county if we as the members of the First Baptist Church would love them like Jesus loved them. Will you commit yourself to do that today? Will you pray, God, give me an opportunity every day just to love somebody? And when they say, why did you do this? You can say it's because Jesus loves you. And friend, I want to tell you, they'll listen to a message like that. There's one final thing here I want us to notice, and that is perfect love's confidence. Now, this is where we get on shouting ground. Perfect love's confidence. Verse number 17, he says that love has been perfected among us in that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in the world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out all fear, because fear involves torment, but he who fears has not been made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. Now, obviously, what he's talking about, listen carefully, he's talking about us being able to live in the presence, having confidence and boldness when we think about God's judgment in the future. He's saying, I want you to know that there is a way that you can escape fear, that you can have boldness, that you can have confidence when you think about that day of having to stand and face the God of the universe. Obviously, he's talking to believers only here because unbelievers can't have that. Friend, unbelievers will never be able to stand with boldness and confidence as they stand before God. They'll be standing there with fear in their hearts. Unbelievers on that day, I'll guarantee you, they will not stand there boldly and shout out their profanities and their blasphemies. Instead, they will cry out for the rocks and the hills, to fall on them and hide them from the wrath of the Lamb. That's what John the Revelator says. And John says, but when it comes to believers, man, believers don't have to live in that kind of fear. And John gives us three reasons for that. Number one is because of his, that's Jesus, his payment for us. You see, when it comes to the idea of having to pay for our sins and to give an accountability for our sins and to give an answer to God for our sins, friend, that judgment's past. It occurred way back yonder. That judgment took place at the cross of Calvary. There Jesus paid for our sins. So we can have confidence in knowing that we will never stand before what John the Revelator calls as the great white throne judgment of God. When I got saved, my pastor gave me a verse. It's a verse that I've remembered until this day, because my pastor told me when I got saved that Sunday afternoon, he said, now just as sure as you walk out of this building today, you're going to doubt your salvation tomorrow. And you're going to live with fear in your heart of facing the judgment of God. And he gave me John chapter 5, verse 24. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life and shall not come unto judgment, but is passed from death unto life. Boy, isn't that a great verse? See, because of his payment for us, we never have to worry about facing the judgment of God. Jesus paid it all. All to him we owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, but hallelujah, he washed it white as snow. Number one is his payment for us, but number two is his promise to us. Now, I want to show you a promise that's given down here in verse number 17, the latter part of that verse. And I'll just bet, even you Bible scholars, I'll just bet you've never paid attention to this promise. It's an amazing promise. I mean, it's an amazing collection of monosyllables. There are nine one-syllable words that are mentioned here. Two only have two letters. Verse 17c. We can have boldness during the day of judgment because as he is, so are we in this world. Now, I want you to underline that and think about that a moment. As he is now, so are we now in this world. He's not talking about what Jesus was then, but what Jesus is now. Friend, what Jesus is now is different from what Jesus was then, before the days of his incarnation. Before the days of his incarnation, he was eternal, self-existing, uncreated. He was the second member of the Godhead. He was God the Son. He was omniscient and omnipotent and omnipresent. He was of purer eyes than to behold evil back then. Nobody ever slapped him in the face back then. No one ever mocked him back then. No one ever spit on him back then. No one ever nailed him naked to a tree. That's what he was back then. Dear friend, John says, as he is now. How is he now? Now he is in heaven. Now he is battle scarred. Now he is wearing the marks of Calvary. Now he is seated upon the Father's throne in a glorified human body that he got the moment he was raised from the dead. That's how he is now. And John didn't say, this is astonishing. John didn't say, as he is now, you will be then. John said, as he is now, you are now. as Jesus is right now in his glorified human body, seated on his Father's throne, as he is right now, we are right now in this world. What in the world is he saying? He is saying that in the eyes of God, God already sees us as having been glorified. That's how God sees us now. So if God sees me right now as already having been glorified in my glorified body in heaven, God sees me now like that, what could ever happen that could take that away? And the answer is absolutely nothing. Friend, I don't have confidence in me. I have confidence in him. What an amazing promise. As a matter of fact, Romans chapter 8 says the same thing, just a commentary on what John said. Romans 8:29, for whom he foreknew, he also predestined to become conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he predestined, them he also called. Those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, that happened when you got saved, he also glorified at that moment. How could we ever fear facing judgment when God says, as Jesus is now, so you are now in this world? Now you go home and chew on that for a while, and if it don't put some shout in your shouter, something's wrong with your shouter. See, we don't have to fear judgment in the future. Because of his payment for us, because of his promise to us, and because, lastly, of his passion for us. In verse number 18 of 1 John, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out all fear. No fear. You know what John is saying? John is saying that when you live in the security of God's love for you, which is perfect love, and you live expressing that love to others, you do not have to live in fear, because you are the beloved of God. Friend, there is one thing today that I want you, when you leave this service, I want you today to leave with this one thought in your mind: God loves me. Can you do that? Can you exit the building today as a child of God saying to yourself, God loves me? Not God thinks about me. Not God provides for me. But God loves me. Friend, it is one thing to know the love of a dear wife, to know the love of a kind husband, to know the love of a tender-hearted mother, to know the love of a sweet child, but to know the love of God is infinitely better. The amazing God of creation that scooped out the seas and heaped up the mountains and hung the stars into space and sits on the circle of the earth, this God loves me. No matter who you are, what you're in, what your past is, what your present is, God loves me. 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 Not just the world. He loves me. I read a true story about a little boy. His name was Chad. And this little boy whose name was Chad, he was kind of raised on the other side of the tracks and kind of an outcast little fella, shy, quiet, kind of an introvert. And little Chad came to his mom one February and he said to her, I want to make a Valentine for everybody in my class, every student, all 35 of them. I want to make every one of my friends this little Valentine as an expression of love. It broke his mother's heart when he heard that because she knew what her son was like. And she had watched them come home from school, and she had seen it happen over and over again. Other children would be laughing and playing with one another, and little Chad would always be left behind. He was never included in the group. But his mother went along with him because he so wanted to do it. And so she went out and bought some crayons and some glue and some paper, and they began to work on those Valentines. Worked on them every night till late at night. Finally, Valentine's Day came. And man, little Chad was up early, excited, smile on his face. Filled his little backpack with those 35 Valentines. Bolted out the door. And his mama said, "You know, today's going to be a bad day for my son." So she baked him his favorite cookies and wanted to have them for him when he got home. And so the time came when it was about time for Chad and his friends to come walking up, and she put the cookies and the milk on the table. She heard the other little kids playing out front as they were making their way into the neighborhood. She looks out the window, and there are all the other little kids playing and laughing with one another. And there, as usual, is little Chad bringing up the rear. Of course, he was discounted by everybody. But she said this time it was different because it seemed like he was just walking a little faster than he normally did. She said, "I knew that when he got into the house, he was going to be heartbroken." She said, "I knew it because I just thought, you know, he probably didn't get many, if any, Valentines expressing love for him." The little fella came in the door, had a big smile on his face, walked right by his mother, headed to the cookies, and as he's headed there to the table, all the while he's saying, "Not one, not one, not one single one." And she's thinking, "Oh my, nobody gave him anything." But then he added something to it. "Not one, not one, not one single one. I did not forget one." Friend, Jesus didn't either. When he died on the cross for the world, he did not forget one. No, not one. And not being trite, nor being flippant, I think that God says to everybody in here today, be my Valentine. I love you. Friend, God loves you. Don't you want to know him? If you don't, give your life to him. Would you stand, please? Heads are bowed and eyes closed. And Father, thank you for the love of God. I feel like a blind man groping in the darkness trying to describe what it is. But I thank you that we can rejoice in knowing it. We can experience it. God, I simply pray that if there is somebody here today who walked into this place feeling like no one loved them, today they would recognize that for the lie that it is, because the most important one loves them. And I pray for that one who does not have a personal relationship with him, that today they would come forward and tell one of our counselors, "I want to give my life to Christ and I want to experience the love of God in my heart," and give those of us who do know you a strong desire and conviction and commitment to express that love wherever we go. starting in our own homes and families, to our spouses and children and parents, and then to strangers that we don't know. For those who need a church home, and God, you've led them here, may they come. But I pray that as the invitation is extended, those who need to would say yes to the love of God today. In Jesus' name I pray. Heads are bowed, eyes closed.
I'm so glad that you've chosen to tune in to our broadcast. And it's the prayer of my heart as you have walked into our worship center by way of television that you have been encouraged as you have listened to the great music that's been provided by our sanctuary choir and orchestra, and as you have listened to the instruction that has come from God's Word, that you really have been strengthened with something that will help you in your walk with God. And if you have yet to discover the wonderful gift of salvation that is provided to us through Jesus Christ our Lord, I pray that you might call upon His name.